from something I'm working on, which has the working title of Europa, and it will take the form of a number of not exactly short stories, probably about six sort of novella length things, which will have sort of relations with each other. The section, the one published in Europa, probably about half of it was published, concerns some Hungarians coming to London in the present day to do some sort of work. And the read is a bit where they were. Zoli met them at Luton Airport in a silver Mercedes. The flight had been uneventful. The plane was full, but Garbo had paid for priority boarding and they had seats together. Olash squashed into the window seat, Garbo stretching his legs in the aisle, and Emma between them, listening to her iPod and staring at the plastic seat back a few inches from the tip of her nose. When the plane descent flattened out and the trolley approached, Garbo bought himself and Bolash cans of beer, two each, and Emma a Diet Coke. With barely enough space to lift the beer to his lips, Bolash concentrated on the window. There was nothing to see, except a section of wing, the fierce light, and the endless expanse of white fluffiness far below. You'd fall straight through it, he thought, solid as it looks. He wasn't sure now that he had understood what Garbo had meant when he said that Emma would be doing some work in London. Had he even heard him? The light hurt his eyes and he half lowered the plastic shutter. He folded his swollen hands in his lap and sat there, his mind snagged on the serrated whisper of her headphones, only just perceptible over the massive white noise of the labouring engines. Zoli was tall and not unhandsome, a man whose moustache that would consider. He also had an air of slightly savage intelligence about him. He was in fact a fully qualified doctor, though not currently practising. It was true that there was an unhealthy puffiness to his face, a swollenness, his eyes protruding more than his ideal. But Bolash did not notice these things until he saw them intermittently in the rearview mirror. He was sitting at the back of the Mercedes with Emma, the lowered leather arm rest emphatically separating as they made their way towards London. They did so with single-minded speed, Zoli pushing a powerful car through holes in the traffic on the motorway. Holding onto the spring-hinged handle over the window, Bolash saw fleeting past the landscape somehow more thoroughly filled than any in his own country. It seemed more orderly. It was very obviously more money. Even now, in the middle of summer, everything looked fairly plump and fresh. Garbo lit a cigarette. He was sitting in the front with Zoli, who immediately told him to put it out. Garbo apologised and pressed it into the ashtray. Still forcing the car forward, Zoli pulled the ashtray out of its hole, lowered his window and shook it out into the loud wind. When the window was up again, he explained that he had borrowed the car from a friend of his who had a luxury limousine hire service. He promised he wouldn't smoke in it. Sorry, Garbo said again. Then he said, this is the new S-Class, yeah? Nice car. Zoli agreed vaguely. He looked in the rearview mirror and for a moment Bolash saw his swollen eyes. Zoli was in his mid-30s probably, only a few years older than the others. Even so, Garbo was having trouble relating to him as an equal. Something he normally managed quite easily with older and more important seeming men. A quality that was probably the source of much of whatever professional success he had enjoyed. They had made some small talk as they drove out of the airport, though even that was abruptly ended, Garbo was in the middle of saying something, and Zoli had to pay for the parking. As they headed into London, Garbo's usual effortless friendliness seemed to have faltered. Whether that was because he was simply intimidated by Zoli, or for some other reason, Bolash did not know. Seeing him shake hands with some formality in the arrivals lounge, the situation had seemed to him to be this. They had met before, but did not know each other well. Zoli and Emma, on the other hand, seemed never to have met. Garbo introduced them, again with a strange sort of formality. Zoli was very friendly to her, a wide smile, a pair of kisses. To Bolash, obviously the minder, with his shit clothes and his muscles, he had offered only a peremptory handshake. Then he had hurried them to the short-term car park. They were in a hurry because, as Zoli said, there's one tonight, whatever that meant. What with the delay, they were pressed for time, so they had first to go to the flat. Zoli, it seemed, had sorted out a flat for them to stay in while they were in London. They spent some time stuck in traffic, the flow of the motorway silting up as it entered the metropolis. It was slowed by traffic lights. The air conditioning was on. Outside the tinted windows, London, what they were able to see of it, sweltered. Then there were smaller thoroughfares, a more local look to things. There were neighbourhoods, parks, high streets, overflowing parks. impressions of urban life on an electric summer evening. It went on for over an hour. Then they arrived at the flat. It was on a quiet street with a few trees in it. Small two-story houses, all exactly the same. They waited with their luggage and duty-free while Szalay opened the front door. Swearing to himself, he struggled with the unfamiliar keys. The flat was on the upper floor of a house, up some narrow stairs, at the top of which there was another struggle with the keys, and then they went in. One bedroom, white and sparsely furnished. Collage would take the sofa in the living room, which overlooked the quiet road. On the other side of the landing, lurking mustily, was a windowless bathroom, into which Emma disappeared with her wash bag as soon as they arrived. The men waited in the living room. Barbara on the sofa, Szalay pacing slowly and taking in the view from the uncurtained window, and then pacing again. And Bolas just standing there, staring at the old lime-coloured carpet and its mass of cigarette burns and other blemishes. From his sprawl on the sofa, Garble wondered out loud whether there was someone to get something to eat. Szalay offered only an uninterested shrug. He said he didn't know the area well. Like Mercedes, he said, he had borrowed the flat from a friend. He himself lived in another part of London. Turning back to the window, he said the high street was nearby. There'd be something there. Do you mind popping out, Garble said to Bolas, and getting some kebabs or something? Bolas looked up from the carpet. Okay. Do you want something, Garble said. The question was addressed to Szalay, but he was still staring out the window and didn't answer. Szalay, Garble said, slightly tentatively. Do you want something? No, he said without turning. Okay, so yeah, just get some kebabs, Garble said. Bolas nodded. Then he said, how many should I get? I don't know. I'll have one. Do you want one? Yeah. And Emma might want one. Four, Garble suggested.